Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Climate Casino, Risk, Uncertainty, and Economics for a Warming World by William Nordhaus. Narrated by Graham Winton. Part 1. The Genesis of Climate Change. From Irving Fisher. Risk varies inversely with knowledge. Chapter 1. First Encounters in the Climate Casino. If you read the newspaper, listen to the radio, or scan the daily blogs, you're virtually certain to encounter stories about global warming. Here's a sample from a variety of sources. The last decade was the warmest on record. The most inconvenient fact is the lack of global warming for well over 10 years now. Polar bears could disappear within a century. Global warming claims are a hoax. The Greenland ice sheet has experienced record melting. Clearly, global warming is getting a lot of attention today. And just as clearly, people disagree about whether it's real, whether it's important, and what it means for human societies. What should the interested citizen conclude from these conflicting stories? And if the answer is that global warming is real, how much does it matter? Where should our concerns about global warming rank among the other issues we face, such as persistent unemployment, a soaring public debt, low-intensity wars, and nuclear proliferation? The short answer is that global warming is a major threat to humans and the natural world. I'll use the metaphor that we are entering the climate casino. By this, I mean that economic growth is producing unintended but perilous changes in the climate and Earth systems. These changes will lead to unforeseeable and probably dangerous consequences. We're rolling the climate dice. The outcome will produce surprises, and some of them are likely to be perilous. But we have just entered the climate casino, and there's time to turn around and walk back out. This book describes the science, economics, and politics involved, and the steps necessary to undo what we're doing. A roadmap of the terrain ahead. Global warming is one of the defining issues of our time. It ranks along with violent conflicts and economic depressions as a force that will shape the human and natural landscapes for the indefinite future. Global warming is also a complex subject. It spans disciplines from basic climate science, ecology, and engineering to economics, politics, and international relations. And the result is a book with many chapters. Before embarking on an extended journey, readers may find it useful to look at a map of what lies ahead. Here are the major themes discussed in the five parts that follow. Part 1 surveys the science of global warming. Climate science is a dynamic field, but the essential elements have been developed by Earth scientists over the last century and are well established. The ultimate source of global warming is the burning of fossil or carbon-based fuels, such as coal, oil, and natural gas, which leads to emissions of carbon dioxide, CO2. Gases such as CO2 are called greenhouse gases, GHGs. They accumulate in the atmosphere and stay there for a long time. Higher atmospheric concentrations of GHGs lead to surface warming of the land and oceans. The initial warming effects are amplified through feedback effects in the atmosphere, oceans, ice sheets, and biological systems. The resulting impacts include changes in temperatures, as well as impacts on temperature extremes, precipitation patterns, storm location and frequency, snowpacks, river runoff, water availability, and ice sheets. Each of these will have profound impacts on biological and human activities that are sensitive to the climate. Past climates, varying from ice-free to snowball Earth, were driven by natural sources. Current climate change is increasingly caused by human activities. The major driver of global warming is the emissions of CO2 from the burning of fossil fuels. CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere were 280 parts per million, ppm, in 1750, and have reached 390 ppm today. Models project that, unless forceful steps are taken to reduce fossil fuel use, They will reach 700 to 900 ppm by 2100. According to climate models, this will lead to a warming averaged over the globe in the range of 3 to 5 degrees centigrade by 2100, with significant further warming after that. So unless there's either a major slowdown in economic growth or strong steps to curb CO2 emissions sharply, we can expect continued accumulations of CO2 emissions in the atmosphere, and the resulting global warming with all its consequences. Part 2 analyzes the impact of climate change. The major concerns aren't temperature per se, but the effects on human and natural systems. A central concept in analyzing impacts is whether a system can be managed. The non-agricultural sectors of high-income countries are highly managed, and this feature will allow these sectors to adapt to climate change at relatively low cost for at least a few decades. However, many human and natural systems are unmanaged or unmanageable and are highly vulnerable to future climate change. While some sectors or countries may benefit from climate change, there are likely to be significant disruptions in areas that are closely tied to climate-sensitive physical systems. The potential damages are likely to be most heavily concentrated in low-income and tropical regions, such as tropical Africa, Latin America, coastal states, and the Indian subcontinent. Vulnerable systems include rain-fed agriculture, seasonal snowpacks, coastal communities, river runoffs, and natural ecosystems. There is potential for serious impacts in these areas. Scientists are particularly concerned about tipping points in the Earth's systems. These involve processes in which sudden or irreversible changes occur as systems cross thresholds. Many of them operate at such a large scale that they are effectively unmanageable by humans with existing technologies. Four important global tipping points are the rapid melting of large ice sheets, such as Greenland, large-scale changes in ocean circulation, such as the Gulf Stream, feedback processes, where warming produces more warming, and enhanced warming over the long run. These tipping points are particularly dangerous because they're not easily reversed once they're triggered. Part 3 discusses the economic aspects of strategies to slow climate change. There are several potential strategies for slowing climate change, but the most promising is mitigation, or reducing emissions of CO2 and other GHGs. Unfortunately, this approach is expensive. Studies indicate that it will cost in the range of 1 to 2% of world income, $600 to $1,200 billion annually at today's level, to attain international climate targets, even if this is undertaken in an efficient manner. While some miraculous technological breakthroughs might conceivably be discovered that can reduce the costs dramatically, experts don't see them arriving in the near future. The economics of climate change is straightforward. When we burn fossil fuels, we inadvertently emit CO2 into the atmosphere, and this leads to many potentially harmful impacts. Such a process is an externality, which occurs because those who produce the emissions don't pay for that privilege, and those who are harmed aren't compensated. One major lesson from economics is that unregulated markets cannot efficiently deal with harmful externalities. Here, unregulated markets will produce too much CO2 because there is zero price on the external damages of CO2 emissions. Global warming is a particularly thorny externality because it's global and extends for many decades into the future. Economics points to one inconvenient truth about climate change policy. For any policy to be effective, it must raise the market price of CO2 and other GHG emissions. Putting a price on emissions corrects for the underpricing of the externality in the marketplace. Prices can be raised by putting a regulatory, tradable limit on amount of allowable emissions, cap and trade, or by levying a tax on carbon emissions. A carbon tax. A central lesson of economic history is the power of incentives. To slow climate change, the incentive must be for everyone. Millions of firms and billions of people spending trillions of dollars to increasingly replace their current fossil fuel-driven consumption with low-carbon activities. The most effective incentive is a high price for carbon. Raising the price on carbon will achieve four goals. First, it will provide signals to consumers about which goods and services are carbon-intensive and should therefore be used more sparingly. Second, it will provide signals to producers about which inputs are carbon-intensive, such as coal and oil, and which use less or no carbon, such as natural gas or wind power, thereby inducing firms to move to low-carbon technologies. Third, it will give market incentives for inventors, innovators, and investment bankers to invent, fund, develop, and introduce new low-carbon products and processes. Finally, a carbon price will economize on the information that is required to undertake all these tasks. Part 4 examines the central questions of climate change policy. How sharply should countries reduce CO2 and other GHG emissions? What should be the profile of emissions reductions? How should the reductions be distributed across industries and countries? What policy tools, taxes, market-based emission caps, regulations, or subsidies are most effective? It's tempting to set climate objectives as hard targets based on climate history or ecological principles. The simple target approach is unworkable because it ignores the costs of attaining the goals. Economists advocate an approach known as cost-benefit analysis, in which targets are chosen by balancing costs and benefits. Because the mechanisms involved in climate change and impacts are so complex, economists and scientists rely on computerized integrated assessment models to project trends, assess policies, and calculate costs and benefits. One major finding of integrated assessment models is that policies to slow emissions should be introduced as soon as possible. The most effective policies are ones that equalize the incremental or marginal costs of reducing emissions in every sector and every country. Effective policies should have the highest possible participation, that is, the maximum number of countries and sectors should be on board as soon as possible. Free riding should be discouraged. Moreover, an effective policy is one that ramps up gradually over time, both to give people time to adapt to a high carbon price world and to tighten the screws increasingly on carbon emissions. While all approaches agree on the three central principles, universal participation, equalizing marginal costs in all uses in a given year, and increasing stringency over time, there are big differences among analysts on the stringency of policies. Our analysis suggests that policy should aim for limiting temperature to a range between 2 degrees Celsius and 3 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, here taken to be the 1900 temperature, depending upon costs, participation rates, and discounting. The lower target is appropriate if costs are low, participation rates are high, and the discount rate on future economic impacts is low. A higher target would apply for high costs, low participation rates, and high discounting. An effective policy must necessarily be global in scope. Earlier treaties, such as the Kyoto Protocol, were ineffective because they provided no incentives to encourage participation. Countries have strong incentives to free ride on the efforts of others because emissions reductions are local and costly, while the benefits are diffuse and distant over space and time. An effective global arrangement will need an effective mechanism to encourage participation and discourage free riding. The most promising approach is to impose import tariffs on the products and services of non-participants. This will be sufficiently burdensome that it will encourage most countries to participate in an international climate regime. As Part 5 discusses, a realistic appraisal must recognize the high hurdles on the road to effective policies to slow global warming. Even though climate scientists have made great strides in understanding the basic trends, it's proven difficult to implement policies to slow climate change. One major reason for the slow progress is the nationalist dilemma, which leads to free riding. Countries that don't participate in a global agreement to reduce emissions get a free ride on the costly abatement undertaken by other countries. This incentive leads to a non-cooperative free riding equilibrium, in which few countries undertake strong climate change policies, a situation that closely resembles the current international policy environment. They speak loudly but carry no stick at all. A link whereby non-participants are penalized through international trade tariffs would help alleviate the free-riding syndrome. Additionally, there's a tendency for the current generation to ride free by pushing the costs of dealing with climate change onto future generations. Generational free-riding occurs because most of the benefits of emissions reductions today would accrue many decades in the future. The double free-riding difficulties are aggravated by interest groups that muddy the water by providing misleading analysis of climate science and economic costs. Contrarians highlight anomalies and unresolved scientific questions while ignoring the strong evidence supporting the underlying science and current projections of climate change. The need to introduce effective policies has been particularly difficult in the United States, where ideological opposition has hardened even as scientific concerns have become increasingly grave. Three steps for today. Concerned citizens naturally wonder what we should do right now to slow the trajectory of global warming. This is a complex process involving the public, the economy, and technology. I would emphasize three specific items to focus on. First, people around the world need to understand and accept the gravity of the impacts of global warming on the human and natural world. Scientists must continue intensive research on every aspect from science to ecology to economics to international relations. People should be alert to the trumped-up claims of contrarians who find 1,000 reasons to wait for decades to take the appropriate steps. Second, nations must establish policies that raise the price of CO2 and other greenhouse gas emissions. While such steps meet resistance, like our aversion to taking foul-tasting medicine, they are essential elements for curbing emissions, promoting low-carbon technologies, and thereby inoculating our globe against the threat of unchecked warming. Moreover, we need to ensure that actions are global and not just national. While politics may be local, and the opposition to strong steps to slow warming comes from nationalistic attitudes, slowing climate change requires coordinated global action. Third, it's clear that rapid technological change in the energy sector is central to the transition to a low-carbon economy. Current low-carbon technologies cannot substitute for fossil fuels without a substantial economic penalty on carbon emissions. Developing economical low-carbon technologies will lower the cost of achieving our climate goals. Moreover, if other policies fail, low-carbon technologies are the last refuge for achieving our climate goals. Therefore, governments and the private sector must intensively pursue low-carbon, zero-carbon, and even negative carbon technologies. These three themes will run through this entire book: increased public awareness, pricing of carbon and other greenhouse gas emissions, and accelerating research on technologies to decarbonize our economies. The circular flow of climate change, impacts and policy. We can think of the discussion in this book as the logical circular flow from emissions to impacts, and finally back to emissions, closing the circle. The global warming problem starts where economic growth and distorted price signals from the market lead to rapidly rising emissions of CO2 into the atmosphere. CO2 concentrations and other forces then lead to major changes in the climate system. The changing climate then produces impacts on human and natural systems. And finally, society responds to the threat of climate change. However, these last links do not yet exist. As of 2013, there are no effective international agreements to limit the emissions of CO2 and other greenhouse gases. If we continue along our current path of virtually no policies, then the globe will continue on the dangerous path of unrestrained global warming. Chapter 2: A Tale of Two Lakes. Although our world is huge and seems impervious to human insults Life on Earth is, in fact, a fragile system. It's full of organisms, linked together in a complex web of relationships, all of which are made possible by the warmth of the sun and the protection of the atmosphere. We need only look at our moon, which receives about the same amount of solar radiation each year as the Earth, to recognize the contingency of our Earth's systems. There on the moon, but for the grace of our atmosphere, would we go. Perhaps living systems have evolved elsewhere in the universe, but it seems highly unlikely that the living systems of our Earth, our plants, animals, humans, and human civilizations, are found anywhere else. The drama that is life on Earth will play only once. I can illustrate the fragility of life on Earth with the tale of two lakes. The first is a small string of salt ponds in southern New England, where I love to visit in the summer. 20,000 years ago, during the last ice age, New England was buried under a mountain of glacial ice. The ponds were coastal estuaries, left behind as the glaciers retreated. Today, they are home or way station for piping plovers, least terns, horseshoe crabs, and multicolored jellyfish. On the ocean side of the ponds are long barrier beaches. The ponds are vulnerable spots, subject to abuse from many quarters. Developers, hurricanes, and motorboats all beat upon the fragile coastline. Conservationists, ecologists, and environmental agencies fight back. In recent years, there's been a standoff between the forces of preservation and those of degradation. What will these ponds look like in a century? The answer depends on our actions over the coming years. If we succeed in stopping climate change, in 100 years they may be as beautiful as they are today. However, if CO2 emissions continue unchecked, the combination of warming, changes in ocean chemistry, and sea level rise may turn them into dead salt marshes. Death is already approaching a second lake. The Aral Sea in Central Asia was once the fourth largest lake in the world, but over the last half century, it shrunk from 26,000 square miles to about one-tenth that size, roughly akin to New York State shrinking to the size of Connecticut. What caused this? It was nothing dramatic like a hurricane or war or ruthless exploitation under runaway capitalism. The cause was primarily bad economic planning, driven by perverse incentives. The centrally planned socialist Soviet Union decided to divert the rivers that feed the lake for irrigation of marginal lands. Like a child starved of nutrition, the lake is slowly dying. This tale of two lakes tells the story of this book in the simplest way. We humans control the future of our planet, with its lakes, forests, and oceans brimming with life. Our living Earth has many enemies. Global warming is our focus, but it takes place alongside unchecked market forces, war, political wooden-headedness, and poverty. We first need to understand the destructive forces at work. Then, through a combination of scientific analysis, careful planning, good institutions, and appropriate channeling of market forces, we can preserve the unique heritage around us. This book examines but one of the issues that we must address to preserve our world: global warming. Humans have been contributing to a warmer globe on a small scale for centuries, but the present century is a critical period in which we must curb the unchecked growth in greenhouse gases, particularly those that come from fossil fuels. If we haven't largely reduced the impact of these gases by this century's end, the environmental future of the Earth is grim. A personal perspective. The purpose of this book is to put global warming in perspective so that concerned citizens can understand and come to an informed judgment about it. In these pages, I discuss the problem from start to finish, from the beginning where warming originates in our personal energy use, to the end where societies take steps to reduce the dangers of warming. This book will be interesting primarily for readers who want to learn what science and economics have to say about global warming. An open mind will help here. If you're already convinced that global warming is just a vast left-wing conspiracy launched by people trying to micromanage our lives, it's unlikely to change your view. At the other pole, if you've already concluded that the world is headed toward climatic Armageddon, you may dismiss this book as underestimating the seriousness of the threat. But most people's views are somewhere in between. They're pulled in different directions by the competing arguments and may view the debate like a courtroom argument between lawyers. What this book does is listen to both sides, review the evidence in as fair and unbiased a manner as possible, and present the best that science and economics have to offer. Notice that I called this section a personal perspective. As with any subject of scientific inquiry, there are solid facts. But each of us inevitably views these facts from a different vantage point. By studying the subject at hand carefully, from our own perspective, and merging our observations with different ones, we can arrive at a more complete understanding. What is my perspective? I'm an economist working at a research and teaching university. I have taught and written in many areas of economics, particularly environmental economics and macroeconomics. I am the co-author of a textbook in introductory economics that's now in its 19th edition. And that experience has given me a special appreciation for people who are struggling with new ideas. I've also studied and written on the economics of global warming for more than 3 decades. I've participated in many studies sponsored by the U.S. National Academy of Sciences since warming first became a serious issue. I have written 3 books, as well as several dozen specialized journal articles on the economics of global warming. I teach the economics of energy and global warming to undergraduates. Moreover, the rhetorical wars about global warming are familiar territory because I've witnessed similar battles in different areas of economics and national budget policy. My experience tells me that we need to cool down the rhetoric so that we can understand the underlying issues. You might be asking yourself whether we really need another book on global warming. If so, why read a book about global warming by an economist? Isn't this really a scientific issue? Yes, the natural sciences are essential to understand why climate change occurs, as well as to determine the pace and regional dimensions of change. Clearly, we cannot hope to understand the problems of warming without studying the basic findings of Earth scientists. But global warming begins and ends with human activities. It begins as the unintended side effect of economic activities, growing food, heating our homes, and even going to school. To understand the linkage between economic activity and climate change requires an analysis of our social systems, which are the subjects of the social sciences, such as economics. Moreover, designing effective measures to slow or prevent climate change requires understanding not only the physical laws that carbon dioxide obeys, but also the more fluid laws of economics and politics, those that involve human behavior. Our policies must be well-grounded scientifically, but the best science in the world will not by itself change the way people spend their incomes or heat their homes. It will take policies based on a sound understanding of human behavior to change the direction of economic growth toward a low-carbon world. So getting the science right is the first step in mapping the way humans are changing our future climate. But understanding the economic and political dimensions is essential for designing ways to fix the problem. I wrote this book particularly for young people, and I dedicate it to my grandchildren. They and their generation will inherit this world and are likely to live through the 21st century. The globe, at century's end, will be vastly different than it is today. The condition of our planet will depend on the steps we take in the interim. But those to slow global warming are perhaps the most momentous of the natural world. I hope that our grandchildren can look back in the years ahead and say that this generation had the resolve to reverse the dangerous course we are currently on. Chapter 3. The Economic Origins of Climate Change. Most people think that global warming is a question for the natural sciences, that it primarily involves heat waves, melting ice sheets, droughts, and storms. True, scientific controversies have been central to public debates about global warming. However, in reality, the ultimate source, and the solutions, lies in the realm of the social sciences. Why is climate change an economic problem? Begin by stepping back and asking a basic question. Why is global warming such a special problem? Why is it a global problem and not a national problem or a household problem? Why is it such a persistent problem? The economics of climate change is straightforward. Virtually everything we do involves, directly or indirectly, the combustion of fossil fuels, which results in emissions of carbon dioxide, CO2, into the atmosphere. The CO2 accumulates over many decades, changes the Earth's climate, and leads to many potentially harmful impacts. The problem is that those who produce the emissions don't pay for that privilege, and those who are harmed aren't compensated. When you buy a head of lettuce, you pay for the costs of producing it, and the farmers and retailers are compensated for their efforts. But when producing the lettuce requires the combustion of fossil fuel, to pump the water that irrigated the lettuce field, or to fuel the truck that delivered the lettuce, one important cost isn't covered: the damage caused by the CO2 that's emitted. Economists call such costs externalities because they are external to, i.e., not reflected in, the market transactions. An externality is a byproduct of economic activity that causes damages to innocent bystanders. These are also called public goods in the economics literature, but the term externality is more intuitive and will be used here. Life is full of externalities. Some are harmful, such as when someone dumps arsenic into a river and kills the fish. Others are beneficial, such as when a researcher discovers a polio vaccine. But global warming is the Goliath of all externalities because it involves so many activities. It affects the entire planet. It does so for decades and even centuries. And, most of all, because none of us acting individually can do anything to slow the changes. Global warming is a particularly thorny externality because it is global. Many critical issues facing humanity today, global warming and ozone depletion, financial crises and cyber warfare, oil price shocks and nuclear proliferation, are similarly global in effect and resist the control of both markets and national governments. Such global externalities, whose impacts are indivisibly spread around the entire world, aren't entirely new phenomena, but they are becoming more important because of rapid technological change and the process of globalization. So, global warming is a special problem for two central reasons. It's a global externality caused by people around the world in their everyday activities of using fossil fuels and other climate-affecting measures. And it casts a long shadow into the future, affecting the globe and its people and natural systems for decades and even centuries into the future. Economics teaches one major lesson about externalities. Markets don't automatically solve the problems they generate. In the case of harmful externalities like CO2, unregulated markets produce too much because markets don't put a price on the external damages of CO2 emissions. The market price of jet fuel doesn't include the cost of the CO2 emissions, and so we fly too much. Economists talk about an invisible hand of markets that set prices to balance costs and desires. However, the unregulated, invisible hand sets the prices incorrectly when there are important externalities. Therefore, governments must step in and regulate or tax activities with significant harmful externalities. Global warming is no different from other externalities. It requires affirmative governmental actions to reduce harmful spillovers. Global externalities pose special difficulties because there is no workable market or governmental mechanism to deal with them. There is no world government that can require everyone around the globe to participate in the solution. The absence of a world government makes it difficult to stop the overfishing of whales, rein in dangerous nuclear technologies, and slow global warming. The fact that climate change is both external to markets and global is the central hurdle that policymakers must overcome if they're to slow the pace and avoid the dangers of climate change in the coming years. Why are carbon dioxide emissions rising? Discussions of global warming usually begin with the emissions and accumulation of CO2 and other greenhouse gases, GHGs, in the atmosphere. However, The real starting point is with humans and their daily lives. I will use my own experience as an American living in a mid-sized city, but one could equally well talk about a Nigerian oil worker, a German brewer, or an Indonesian weaver. Suppose I'm invited to give a talk at the University of Connecticut, about 50 miles from my home in New Haven. The most convenient way to get there is to drive my car up and back. The round trip is about 100 miles, and taking into account sitting in traffic and city driving, my car will get about 20 miles per gallon, so I consume 5 gallons of gasoline. This will produce about 100 pounds of CO2, which will come out of the tailpipe and go into the atmosphere. I can't see it, or hear it, or smell it, and I generally don't even think about it. If I'm like most people, I will probably assume that my trip will have no effect on the world's climate, and so I will ignore the consequences. But there are more than 7 billion people around the world making analogous decisions many times every day and every year. Suppose that everyone on Earth consumed the equivalent in fossil fuel energy of my drive twice a week for heating, lighting, cooking, and other activities. All this would add about 30 billion metric tons of CO2 to the world's atmosphere each year, which is what global CO2 emissions were in 2012. Virtually everything we do has some CO2 buried in the process. You might think that riding your bicycle is carbon-free, but a little carbon was emitted in making the bicycle, and quite a bit was involved in building the road or sidewalk. Why in the world do we use this vast quantity of fossil fuels? We use it to drive, to fly, to heat our houses and schools, to run our computers, and for everything we do. Almost 90% of the energy we use comes in the form of fossil fuels, and burning those fuels produces the CO2 emissions. Say we are shocked by how much energy we use and want to cut back. Why can't we simply stop using fossil fuels now that we know about global warming? I discuss this issue in Part 3, but it is so central that a few words are useful here. It turns out that we cannot simply convert to other energy sources by flipping a switch, because those other sources are more expensive. It generally costs more to power our lives with renewable fuels, such as solar power. In some cases, using low-carbon fuels requires a completely different capital stock, new power plants and factories, different engines and furnaces from what exists today, and this adds greatly to the expense. Return to the example of my trip to the University of Connecticut, for which I use my gasoline-powered car. I might decide to buy an electric car instead. It wouldn't emit any CO2, but it would probably use electricity fueled by natural gas, and generating the electricity emits CO2. Similarly, my home furnace burns only natural gas. To convert it to run on solar power would require a major investment, not to mention that the sun doesn't always shine where I live, and it never shines at night. So, for now, like most Americans, I am, for practical purposes, hooked on fossil fuels. Moreover, I enjoy my current lifestyle. I like my car, my computer, and my cell phone. I prefer a warm house in the winter and a cool house in the summer. I definitely don't want to return to a caveman standard of living. Let's look at the net effect of all these decisions around the world on the long-term trend in global CO2 emissions over the period from 1900 to 2010. There have been periods of fast growth and of slow growth, but on average, emissions grew at a rate of 2.6% per year. This upward trend is the source of our worry. These rising emissions are leading to rising CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere, which is what produces climate change. It will be useful to give the global totals here. Global CO2 emissions have been growing because the global economy has been growing. The world's population has expanded from around 2 billion in 1900 to over 7 billion in 2012. In most countries, output of goods and services, gross domestic product, per person, has grown as well. Fortunately, world CO2 emissions haven't been growing as rapidly as world output because of what is called decarbonization. This means, simply, that over time we're using less CO2-rich energy to produce a given amount of output. This is seen in the trend of the carbon intensity of economic activity, which is measured as the ratio of CO2 emissions to output. The reasons for decarbonization are many, but three factors explain most of it. One is that for most products, we use less energy per unit of output today than in earlier years. This is true whether the output is a shirt or a gallon of milk or a telephone call. Another source of decarbonization is that our most rapidly growing economic sectors, such as electronics and healthcare, tend to use less energy per unit of output than sectors that are growing less rapidly or shrinking. In other words, our economic mix is shifting from industries and activities that are more energy intensive to ones that are less so. A final source of decarbonization has been the shift in energy sources away from the most carbon-intensive fuels, for example, coal, toward less carbon-intensive fuels, for example, natural gas, and to renewable and non-fossil sources, for example, nuclear and wind. Let's examine the declining carbon intensity of economic activity for the United States, for which we have reasonably good data going back over a century. It's a fascinating picture. Carbon intensity of the U.S. economy increased until around 1910. This period was the first age of coal. Since 1930, the CO2 gross domestic product, GDP ratio, has fallen at an average of 1.8% per year. While the carbon intensity of production is declining, it's not declining fast enough to reduce total CO2 emissions, either for the world or for the United States. Over the last 8 decades, real output in the United States has grown at an average rate of 3.4% per year, while carbon intensity has declined at 1.8% per year, which means that the CO2 emissions have grown at 1.6%, 3.4 to 1.8, per year. Although high-quality data for the world as a whole aren't available, the best estimates indicate that over the last half century, global output grew at an average rate of 3.7% per year. The rate of decarbonization was 1.1% per year, and CO2 emissions grew at 2.6% per year. So here is the CO2 problem in a nutshell. Countries around the world are growing rapidly, aside from some chronically poor performers, and putting aside recessions as painful but temporary setbacks. And they're using carbon-based resources such as coal and oil as the main fuel for their economic growth. The efficiency of energy use has improved over time, but the rate of improvement is insufficient to bend down the emissions curve. Hence, total CO2 emissions continue to rise. Models as a tool for understanding. Let's step back a moment to review the terrain. We've seen that because of economic growth and increased use of fossil fuels, humans are putting ever larger quantities of CO2 into the atmosphere. The growth of CO2 concentrations is confirmed by scientific monitoring around the world. We need to know the consequences of rising GHG concentrations. Because we cannot calculate all these complicated formulas in our heads, we use computerized models to project the results of past and future economic growth on emissions, climate, and thence upon human and natural systems. So how do economists and natural scientists project future climate change? It's necessarily a two-step procedure. The first step, explained in this chapter, is to estimate the future emissions of CO2 and other important GHGs. The second step is to put those emissions estimates into climate and other geophysical models to project future change in CO2 concentrations, temperature, and other important variables. This second step is discussed in Chapter 4. I begin by discussing an important element in modern natural and social sciences, the use of models. A complete picture of future climate change requires projections of the economy, energy use, CO2 and other emissions, and different climatic variables, along with the impacts in various sectors. A projection is a conditional or if-then statement. It states, if a given set of input events take place, then we calculate that the following output events will occur. Economists often make this kind of projection, as in, given current fiscal and monetary policies, and the impact of the euro crisis, we expect real output to rise 2% next year. Similarly, scientists and economists use projections for future climate change. The main inputs we need are variables like the path of annual CO2 and other GHG emissions. With these inputs and knowledge about the relevant physics, chemistry, biology, and geography, climate scientists can calculate the time paths for temperature and precipitation, sea level, sea ice, and many other variables. Because humans cannot calculate such projections in our heads, they're all done with computerized models. What is a model? There are different kinds of models, from model trains to architectural models to scientific models. The basic idea is that a model is a simplified picture of a more complex reality. Economists represent the complex set of relationships that govern output, inflation, and financial markets using macroeconomic models. These are the mathematical and computerized engines that allow governments and businesses to project events for purposes such as planning the federal budget. Climate models, similarly, use algebraic or numerical equations to represent the dynamics of the atmosphere, oceans, ice, and other related systems. So just think of a climate model as a mathematical representation of the Earth, with different layers of the atmosphere and oceans, running in short time steps of minutes to hours. They are very large models, deploying hundreds of thousands of lines of computer code that have been developed by dozens of teams of scientists in many countries. Many good descriptions of how models are developed are available in books and also online. You might wonder whether climate models are simplified. That is actually their purpose, to simplify, but not to oversimplify. After all, reality is enormously complex. The U.S. economy, for example, includes more than 300 million people, each making hundreds of decisions every day. There is no way to represent this system accurately, in the sense of literally. What we need for economic and climate modeling is to simplify the picture for the purpose at hand. We need the relevant details, not all the details. Let's look at the difference between a simplified model and the full reality. Think of a photograph of a high-voltage transmission line that moves electricity from generators to customers. This is the reality. Now think of a sheet of computer code in GAMS language for the energy system and the economy. The model is a conceptual representation of the complex interactions of the electricity sector along with the rest of the energy system. Which do you prefer? An architect might choose the picture, while someone interested in dealing with climate change would prefer the computer program. A good model, whether of a transmission tower, an economy, or the Earth's climate, should capture the essence of the process without overwhelming the user with unnecessary clutter. In economics, we build models out of output and incomes. For example, to help the government forecast its revenues and spending, and to provide an informed basis of determining what is happening to, say, government debt. A good model of the fiscal situation today doesn't need to contain any information on CO2 emissions, because that would have only a tiny effect on the current budget. To think about climate change, we build models to estimate future emissions of CO2, the impact of those emissions on atmospheric concentrations of CO2, and the changes in climate that result. The government deficit doesn't enter into climate models because it's a second-order or third-order influence on climate change. Building good models is an art as well as a science. It's a science because you need accurate observations and reliable scientific theories. You could build a model based on the idea that the Earth and all life were created 10,000 years ago. But that theory would have deep trouble explaining the history of Long Island, because much of the island is debris left by ice ages more than 10,000 years ago. And you wouldn't know what to make of ice cores from Antarctica, because they contain ice rings going back more than 500,000 years. But modeling is also an art, because you have to simplify to capture the essential details. Some models contain information on all the power plants and transmission links in the United States. But even such a huge enterprise cannot represent power generation in other countries, or international trade in electricity, or the interactions with the rest of the economy, or the carbon cycle. As Leonardo da Vinci is often cited, simplicity is the highest form of sophistication. The great formulas of physics are stunningly simple. The central idea of climate change is also stunning in its simplicity. It is that the average temperature of the Earth changes with the relative concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere. A doubling of CO2 concentrations is expected to lead to a rise in average temperature of around 3 degrees Celsius. Another doubling is expected to produce another 3 degrees Celsius of warming. Unfortunately, the parallel with the law of gravity breaks down at this point. To begin with, we don't know the exact rise in temperature per doubling of CO2. Additionally, the effect may depend upon other factors, especially on the time scale over which the increase takes place. Finally, just as maps are designed for different uses, for example, hiking versus sailing, or driving versus flying, models also are designed for different purposes. Many climate models are extremely detailed and require supercomputers to calculate the trajectories of the components they track. Other simplified models focus on projections of specific outcomes, such as impacts on agricultural output, sea level, or the geographic spread of malarial mosquitoes. Different problems require different models. Integrated assessment models. An important approach for analysis of climate change is a class of integrated assessment models, IAMs. These are comprehensive models that include not only climate, but other aspects of the science and economics of climate change. IAMs combine in one package the end-to-end processes from economic growth through emissions and climate change to impacts on the economy, and finally to the projected effects of policies for slowing climate change. IAMs also contain highly simplified climate models. They attempt to capture the linkage between emissions and climate change without including all the architectural nuts and bolts. The main advantage of IAMs is that they can represent the entire process from start to finish. The main disadvantage is that they simplify some of the processes that are analyzed in greater detail in the more complete models. Many IAMs, large and small, have been developed by modeling teams around the world, and they have proven remarkably useful for understanding the implications of policies to slow climate change. Throughout this book, I rely extensively on IAMs in describing the economic aspects of climate change. Additionally, I often refer to the results of models that have been developed at Yale University by me, students, and colleagues known as the DICE family of models. DICE is short for Dynamic Integrated Model of Climate and the Economy. There is also a more elaborate regional version known as the RICE model. The DICE model has a logical structure similar to the circular flow discussed earlier. An energy economy module generates economic growth and CO2 emissions in different regions over coming decades. Small carbon cycle and climate modules generate global temperature trends. The DICE model includes damage calculations, where damages depend upon the size of the economy and on the temperature increase. Finally, there is a policy module, where countries can either limit emissions or put a price on CO2 emissions, thereby bending down the emissions trajectory. In the simplest global version, the model includes only a few equations and is relatively easy to understand. The more complete RICE model, with 12 major regions such as the United States, China, and India, contains thousands of lines of computer code and is more challenging to grasp. Readers who would like to examine the simple DICE model are encouraged to look at the online version, DICE 2012. You can change the parameters and assumptions, such as the long-run world population or the climate sensitivity, to get a feel for how integrated assessment models work, as well as how sensitive they are to the underlying assumptions. Projections. Basic principles. Understanding future climate change begins with a set of projections for inputs into climate models. These are primarily the paths of emissions of CO2 and other GHGs. To keep the discussion manageable, I focus primarily on CO2 because it's the most important of the GHGs, but complete assessments include other gases as well. When looking at actual projections, I use CO2 equivalent, CO2-E, which adds together the contributions of all the GHGs and expresses them as the effect of an equivalent amount of CO2. How do statisticians and economists make projections? They begin by estimating statistical relationships using the historical data along with the underlying physical laws and economic relationships. With these results, a demographer or economist can make a statistically based projection of future trends. The advantage of this statistical approach is that it can be reproduced and updated. That is, because each of the steps can be performed using publicly available data and computer software, the estimates can be checked or challenged by other scientists. As I discussed earlier, total CO2 emissions are driven by three components: population, GDP per capita, and the carbon intensity of GDP. Mathematically, the CO2 growth rate is equal to the sum of the growth rates of each of the three components. Let's look at the data for 2010 and the projections for 2050 for the United States and for the world. These projections for 2050 assume that countries make no policies to reduce emissions. The estimates come from the Yale DICE model, but they don't differ markedly from those found in other studies. In the United States, population is projected to grow at 0.6% per year, per capita output to grow at 1.7% per year, and the CO2 output ratio to decline at 1.6% per year. On the basis of these assumptions, CO2 emissions would grow at 0.7% per year, increasing emissions by about one-third by mid-century. Similar calculations can be made for different regions. Most economic models have modules for the different components. They might have elaborate energy sector models to project the availability and use of different fuels. The output projections might take into account the capital in structures and equipment, software, technological change, and other factors. But the essential idea can be captured by this example. Now look at projections for the world, including CO2 released by land use changes as well as industrial emissions. If there are no policies to curb emissions, the global total of CO2 emissions is projected to rise about 1.3% per year to mid-century. The difference between the top and bottom projections is primarily due to expectations that developing countries will grow more rapidly than the United States. These projections suggest that there are three ways to reduce emissions: lower population growth, lower growth in living standards, and lower CO2 intensity, decarbonization. People sometimes think that CO2 growth rates are ironclad laws that are unresponsive to economic policy, or perhaps even more pessimistically, that we can only bend down the emissions trajectory by severely limiting growth in living standards or imposing draconian limits on population. Such pessimistic conclusions are an incorrect reading of both history and policy. Societies can bend down the CO2 growth curve by more rapid decarbonization, and if wisely undertaken, that can be done with modest costs. There are many technologies that can produce goods and services with less carbon or even zero net carbon emissions. For example, electricity can be generated with low-carbon fuels, such as natural gas, or with non-carbon fuels, such as nuclear, solar, and wind power. We can develop more efficient appliances and cars. We can better insulate our houses. At some point, we may even be able to remove CO2 from emission streams or from the atmosphere inexpensively. So rather than focusing on painful limits to economic growth, economists tend to emphasize steering the economy toward low-carbon technologies. Let's examine a standard projection of CO2 emissions and their determinants. An important starting point is the baseline, or no policy path of unconstrained CO2 emissions. This provides a reference or starting point for policy. A look at how the world will evolve over the coming years with normal economic growth and unrestrained CO2 emissions. Basically, this estimate combines a projection of economic growth along with the underlying trend toward decarbonization discussed above, but with no limits on CO2 emissions. What did the different IAMs show? For this discussion, examine a group of IAMs surveyed under the aegis of the Energy Modeling Forum, EMF, at Stanford University. The project is called EMF 22. It included modeling teams from around the world, 6 groups from Asia and Australia, 8 from Western Europe, and 5 from North America. 11 of the modeling teams provided results for the baseline scenario of CO2 emissions through 2100. Let's examine the average of the EMF models along with the results of our Yale DICE model, which is used extensively in this book. It's useful to note that the DICE model predicts almost exactly the same growth rate for global CO2 emissions over the next century as the average of the EMF 22 models. Uncertain CO2 trajectories in the climate casino. Let's examine the climate casino at play. A first point that emerges is that all models, every single one, project continued growth in CO2 emissions. Growth rates range between 0.5% and 1.7% per year over the 2000 to 2100 period. Even though these rates look small, they add up to large cumulative changes due to the compounding effect over time. For example, the average growth rate of 1.2% per year means an increase of a factor of 3.3 over a century. These models represent the best efforts of economic and energy experts today, and they indicate that the CO2 problem isn't going to disappear or be magically solved by unrestrained market forces. The second point concerns the uncertainty about future emissions. Because of the momentum of economic and technological systems, the near-term projections show few differences. However, the divergence among different projections splays out as we go further into the future. Model projections of CO2 emissions for 2100 range from 1.6 to 5.4 times higher than in 2000. The reasons for the divergence go back to the determinants of emissions growth and involve differing estimates about economic growth, technology, and energy use in the coming years. Can we pin down the sources of the differences more precisely? A careful analysis finds that the biggest unknown arises from uncertainty about future growth of the world economy. Will the world enjoy robust economic growth like that from 1950 to 2005? Or will it stagnate with slow technological change, recurrent financial crises and depressions, spreading pandemics and occasional widespread wars? These are the most important questions behind the divergent estimates of CO2 emissions. The answers to these deep questions are at this point essentially unknowable, like the role of the wheel in the climate casino. No one can reliably predict roulette wheels, the stock market, or future technologies. Remember that the recent deep recession was a complete surprise for virtually every professional forecaster. Because of the deep uncertainty about future economic growth, the divergence in emissions projections is unlikely to narrow significantly in the next few years. People will naturally wonder how to respond to these vast uncertainties when making climate change policy. Isn't 100 years a long way off? One reaction is to postpone action, to assume that because life is uncertain, we should wait until we know more. Sometimes, if the stakes are low, and we will soon learn the right answer, waiting until the wheel stops spinning is a reasonable approach. But for climate change, waiting for the right answer is a perilous course. It's like driving 100 miles an hour with your headlights off on a foggy night and hoping there are no curves. We're unlikely to resolve the uncertainties soon. Waiting for many years to act is costly because of the delayed responsiveness of the economy and the climate system to our actions. It's less costly to spread our investments over time than to cram them all into a short time when the fog lifts and we see disaster right in our path.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.